Information technologies are dramatically affecting our lives as we move towards the 21st century. Knowledge and the ability to use it are shaping the economies of the future. Computer networks bring people, information, and resources together electronically, allowing members of society to interact and exchange knowledge and ideas. A computer network may be used to link offices within a geographically distributed corporation. This is particularly important in the news industry, where timely access to information is critical.
This system is called InfoLink. And what InfoLink is, it's an information system that links up all the CDC locations across the country. And with the news file, by simply typing R, I can get a rundown of the latest news that's happening. Now, this is CBC-generated stories. It's also stories that are generated by Associated France Press, Reuters, BBC, Broadcast News, Canadian Press, and so on. These are any of a number of stories, and they are updated constantly.
Around the world, there are many computer networks with different functions. User pay network services such as CompuServe, corporate networks, academic networks, school networks, and networks for seniors. There are a growing number of community-sponsored freenets. Each network allows participants to exchange files and electronic mail. Many of these individual networks are being linked to each other to create a worldwide matrix of more than a million computers and over 10 million people, the Internet. Memorial University of Newfoundland has led the province in the integration of international computer networking and manages the Newfoundland Regional Network for Research and Education, NLNet.
NLNet came into being a couple of years ago primarily as a result of a national initiative to build a network for Canada, which became CANet. The reason that I felt that it was so important at the time was because we had been involved in networking with BitNet and felt that while a mail network was a start, that building a full service regional network would have opened up not only to Memorial but to the rest of the province an opportunity to access information in a way well beyond what we were doing, which was very advanced for the province at the time.
This is a project to put in a lot of information about the university online on our computer network, and so it's available from all over the campus. And a lot of universities and large organizations are doing this kind of a project now, so the information about policies and procedures, a lot of information is available about their organizations. We keep the exam schedule on here, and we've got the university calendar online. Open hours, say for the library or for the microcomputer workstation resource center, and we've even got the local bus schedule on there. Because the information is available on our network on campus, that people can get at it really from anywhere on the internet, which means virtually anywhere in the world, and also a lot of other organizations doing similar projects, we can get at their information servers as well, and so we can find online calendar documents from universities all over the world, and we can find policies and procedures, information about pricing and a lot of functions at other universities.
I use several things on the internet. If you think of the internet as a multifaceted creature, it's both a very big enabler of technology and a big provider. One of the things that we get off the network, for example, is news groups. We receive perhaps 30 to 40 megabytes of information per day that we store in local databases that anybody can then retrieve anywhere on campus. And we have about 1,400 news groups of all types of interest, from recreational groups to highly technical groups. I use some of them, for example, to maintain the computer systems. That's my main job. If you follow, for example, the space shuttles, there's a space shuttle launch every month or so. All of the press material is available. You want the press kit, it's there, you can go retrieve it. The network itself is now being used by corporations, conglomerates, the US Geological Survey, for example, the Canadian Atmospheric Environment Services, Since all the material is available electronically, why not make it available to the world?
Well, as a statistical consultant in the department, I like to read some of the electronic news groups that pertain to statistics. There's one I just found this week, which is really, really wonderful list. It's called EdStat, and it talks about teaching statistics. And there's quite an active news group.
I use internet to assist me in my part-time work, doing developmental applications in medical teaching. I've exchanged images with the University of Hong Kong, and I've successfully sent a sonogram image to them. The response sometimes has been overwhelmingly rapid. I would post a message on the network, say in the morning, and I'd have answers in the afternoon, two or three of them. Some of them very, very good. And then the interaction that comes from that could go on for weeks.
The Department of Mathematics and Statistics runs a problem of the week for undergraduate students, so we have been posting this weekly. We've even had a couple of electronic replies, including one from a high school student in this province.
One of the really neat things that I find with this is that the range of people that you encounter in these discussion groups is really quite amazing. There just is an enormous sense of community and helpfulness, and people will really go out of their way in an extraordinary fashion to provide assistance or to provide advice. Just an enormous sense of this community that goes beyond political and geographic bonds.
Many sites with valuable information can be reached through the internet, like the Ocean Information Center at the University of Delaware, the Lunar and Planetary Institute, and the Global Land Information System. There is an online stock market report updated daily, and even a source for the latest earthquake activity around the world. Many satellite images are stored in computer graphics format and are available within an hour of being photographed by the satellite.
You have to realize the internet is almost like a highway. Once you get on the highway, it just brings you to every house that it comes to. A lot of people have welcome mats out. You can go in and explore their sites. I use the NASA sites quite heavily. They have a database of perhaps 20,000 pictures that you can pick up there and bring back and display on a PC or a workstation like mine. This could be anything from astronomical pictures, slides that you can use in presentations, collect them, Earth resources pictures, pictures of the Earth, the planets, whatever they happen to be.
A lot of cities are offering public access networks now. They call them community free networks. And in the United States, there's a big movement to do this under the National Public Telecommunications Network. They're sponsoring freenets in Cleveland and Youngstown. There's a well-known freenet in the San Francisco Bay Area, and there's a number of cities in the States that are starting to offer these. In Canada, there's a number of cities that are getting started with this as well. One is called the National Capital Freenet. It's based in Ottawa. On the community networks, the residents of the community, of the city, are the participants in the network, and the city uses it to broadcast to its citizens information about activities. The Red Cross, local Red Cross, might post information. There's probably a group area for discussion of topics relating to seniors' activities and public forums about what's happening, events in the community. They might have some of the local experts, for example, a mechanic, available to answer questions from people who connect into the system. So anybody can dial in freely to those public community networks just from their own home using a modem that they have at home. And if they don't have computer equipment at home, they can walk into a public library and sit down and use a terminal to access the system.
Memorial University's Queen Elizabeth II Library is a modern, world-class facility. Like many libraries around the world, technology is helping the services of the QE2 Library to evolve in new ways and facilitating many new services.
Libraries across North America are becoming more and more network dependent, and we are joining those libraries by offering our services over the network as well as other libraries in the region, like Dalhousie through NovaNet. We are mounting a large number of resources on Folio, our library system, and then providing remote access to scholars and other researchers across the country. We're on the verge of being able to offer access to remote resources more quickly and more readily than to our own. Because if you can sit at your office at a terminal and call up a copy from Denver, why do you want to walk across the campus to come to the library and stand in a photocopy line for the same article?
What has become apparent is what is perhaps one of the most profound effects of networking on any area or aspect of society, which is upon education. What we have seen at Memorial is just an incredible transformation, in my opinion, and facilitation in terms of how colleagues, academics, are able to interact with each other and access information on a worldwide basis. I know that it's just a wonderful thing that we have to encourage. For teachers, again, we see the same thing.
The project is called Project Ideals, and it's being run by David Krukol, who's directing it from the University of Alabama. And the goals of the project for Krukol and his associates are to enable students to communicate with students from other countries, from other cultural backgrounds, to come to understand the difficulties of cross-cultural communication. For my class, I'm interested in it because I teach a world political problems class, and I'm doing world environmental problems as one of the topics. And the Ideals Project is going to simulate the negotiation of a treaty on law of the sea. Of course, that's directly relevant to us, and it will show that some of the problems and some of the possibilities for achieving international agreements to regulate the use of the sea, common heritage of the sea. I can't think of a better way of involving people, students in world problems, than by having them try to solve problems in a context of a simulation with other students who are from a different environment and different with different goals.
Doug Lawler is a university student who uses the internet as a resource and research tool. Because Doug is blind, he uses artificial speech software and hardware to interface with his computer. This enables him to participate fully in internet activities.
Using the internet, students can access information. They can access libraries, other CDs or CD-ROMs from other sources, and get information on doing projects. There's software also that you can get from other sites. If you're doing chemistry, you could connect to these systems and perhaps get a demo program for chemistry or get a program on how to use the internet and that sort of thing. You can also talk to other people on the internet, and students could talk back and forth about their opinions on where they live on different issues, and you could get debates going over the internet. It's invaluable and limitless what you can do with it.
About 3 years ago, some teachers of the RC school board discovered that you could go point to point and connect computers together, and they became fascinated by this. Some of the teachers learned about the National Geographic's Kids Network, and I provided them with more information. We purchased our first kit and ran a pilot through a school out in Killigrews with a teacher. And since then it's grown. We have two kits and we are running six projects this year. The information that's shared from one location to another. So a school that's out in Killigrew, say, becomes connected with schools all across North America. And So a student who may feel isolated or may not even know enough to feel isolated in killer groups all of a sudden becomes bombarded with data, with maps, with written communication from these schools all across North America. And it does what it does for those students in terms of just sparking their interest in education is one thing, but it's amazing what it does for the students and for the teachers in terms of opening their horizons and looking at the world much more globally than our little educational environment here in a school in Killigrews or Manuals or St. John's.
The AT&T Learning Network is an interactive computer network run by AT&T in the United States, and they are offering their telephone lines around the world to any school who wants to sign on. And using that network, schools like here in Clarenville can broaden their horizons, if you like, and we can join classrooms from Germany or Japan or Los Angeles in everyday work here in the building.
Several students in this school who came from Sweden and Norway, their parents working with the Hibernia Project, and Jessica Swenson, for example, gets online and actually communicates with a student at Bergen in Norway. And the other students are communicating with Norway as well.
STEMnet is a proposed network at this stage, which stands for Science, Technology, Education, and Mathematics. And it's a network to bring together the teachers in every school in the province with school board program coordinators in these areas, and with post-secondary people in the areas of science and technology and math as well. The idea of STEMnet is to give teachers the opportunity in their communities to communicate with other teachers in their subject areas, wherever they live in the province or throughout the world.
In future, I think it's probably the greatest thing that we've ever had in education. It opens the whole world to us, basically. You can ask a question that you don't know, and maybe someone nearby doesn't know, and someone around the world can answer it for you.
It's very good for us here, being at the very tip of North America. Well, we're no longer at the tip of North America. We can be anywhere now. We're just an address away. We can now draw faculty of the caliber who probably wouldn't have come here before, but now they have all the resources of the Internet available to them, and they're not losing any contact with anyone else.
I think the future for the network is that it is going to become more accessible to more people everywhere. I think that at some point people will need the network. I mean, there are a lot of things that it does for a lot of people right now. I think more and more people, be it schools, universities, or even individuals, I think that more and more people will find that they can get a lot out of the network.
As the network becomes more and more a part of everyday life, these resources will be made available to individuals, and I think that the democratization of information is one of the most exciting aspects of the network.
It makes things evolve intellectually, I think, much the way that it does if you have a group of colleagues where you're conversing with them on a daily basis, arguing back and forth, and the sort of intellectual fertilization that happens in those kinds of discussions. And you're now no longer restricted to the guy down the hall. You can do that with somebody that's halfway around the world.
Well, I can foresee, in general, a time in the not-too-distant future where every home, every desk could have network access. That is, I think, theoretically possible and, in fact, very desirable. But we're a very long way, perhaps in practice, away from achieving that because of the resources that are required. Networks are transforming business. They're transforming education. And I think that as we use networks more and more, the only limit will be upon our imagination.
Imagine the possibilities. Sharing your thoughts and ideas with new friends and colleagues in a global electronic community. Access to rich resources across the continent. Integration of technology into the fabric of our society. The world at your fingertips.